Hey there, I'm Peter with Cortical Labs, and welcome to another video on Synthetic Biological Intelligence, or SBI. In this video, we're going to take you into the lab to show you how we turn blood samples into stem cells. This process is technically called dedifferentiation, and it's the first half of a longer process that we use to generate most of the neurons that are used in our lab. So let's head over and let our scientists explain in more detail how this dedifferentiation protocol works.
You're all ready?
Yes,
all ready for this
we're
one?
Here.
Yep. Hi, I'm Brad, one of the cortical lab scientists involved in collecting and purifying blood donations from our informed and consenting human volunteers, and then turning them into stem cells.
Hey guys, I'm Dad. Yes, that's my actual name, Dad. I take care of the neurocell production aspect, that is from maintaining them as healthy stem cells into differentiating them into neuroprogenitors. So let us start with a quick overview of the whole process. So basically up until 2006, where Yamanaka came about with this method where you can take someone's skin cells and turn them into stem cells, it was basically difficult to get stem cells to work with. So it was ethically wrong to take cells from a developing embryo and use them in the lab. But Yamanaka came about with these methods where you can actually turn skin cells or blood sample within 30 to 60 days into iPSCs.
Yeah, and of course, once these new cell lines are made, we store them in liquid nitrogen at ultra low temperatures, around about negative 196 degrees Celsius or negative 321 Fahrenheit. This allows us to keep them in a state of suspended animation for an indefinite period of time, ensuring that they're viable for future experiments that we have planned for them. And once they're thawed, of course, iPSCs have the ability to self-renew, meaning we can, in theory, keep reproducing them in the lab indefinitely. And that provides us with a sustainable source of cells for our ongoing experiments and opens the door to a wide range of research applications we have for CL1. We aim to generate iPSC lines from a variety of individual donors, and that ensures we have a diverse genetic and cellular sample of people for downstream experiments and applications.
Now, how do we get the blood? The procedure is very simple. It's just like going to the hospital and getting your blood taken. There is nothing different about this. We need about 2.5 mils to 10 mils of blood, which is just a tiny bit. That's all that we need to be able to generate stem cells from this.
So once we have the blood sample, it needs to be separated using a density gradient medium like LymphoPrep. The purpose of the separation is that we only want to isolate the buffy coat, which is a thin layer that contains the white blood cells we can use to reprogram. The blood is carefully layered onto the LymphoPrep in a round tube and then loaded into a centrifuge and spun at high speeds. That allows the different components of the blood to separate out based on their relative densities. The heavier red blood cells sink to the bottom while the lighter plasma rises to the top. In between, we'll find the buffy coat, a thin pale layer containing white blood cells, platelets, and some plasma. Once the centrifuge comes to a stop, we carefully collect the buffy coat layer using a transfer pipette or syringe and needle. These cells can either be frozen down for later use or transferred to cell culture for reprogramming immediately.
Yeah, so now we've got our cells. We need to count them because we need to be sure the number of cells we are putting down. So we've got the manual method and the automated method. So the manual method, you put it on a cover slip and then you look it under the microscope, or you can put it in a small slip and then put it in the automated machine. So we need about 500,000 cells to start with. And once we finish with our count using the automated method, now we can freeze the cells so that when we need it, we can bring it out. Or if we want to go straight ahead to reprogram them, we plate these cells down and then we add the factors. So the factors are like giving a baby milk to a baby so that the baby can develop strong bones. But these factors that we are talking about, they are OCT4, SOX2, KLF4, CMAT, and these factors are supposed to push the blood cells into stem cells. We put these factors in the Sendai virus for the virus to deliver it to the cells. And the Sendai virus has been shown to be more efficient and safe as compared to lentivirus and the retrovirus and other methods. And also the Sendai virus doesn't enter into your DNA just as the other viruses does. So it's like, it's just transporting the factors and then it leaves. That's why we use the Sendai virus.
After the Sendai virus, the infected cells are introduced to a cell culture incubator, which aims to provide the right conditions for their growth and survival. Otherwise, of course, they're gonna die very easily. The ones we have here are set to 37 degrees Celsius and 5% CO2. That carbon dioxide concentration maintains the cells in the right pH buffer. Now, over the next couple of weeks, these cells undergo a remarkable transformation. The Sendai virus-mediated reprogramming induces changes in gene expression that gradually turn the PBMCs, or the white blood cells, into cells that share the characteristics of embryonic stem cells.
Just as Brad explained, these cells undergo a lot of reprogramming, a lot of transformation. So once you bring these out, when you take them out of the incubators, they are like little spots, which we call colonies. So we now move these colonies into different wells and we call them as clones. So over a period of 5 to 8 weeks, we need to expand these clones so that we can generate different clones for the same patient. And so every 5 days, you need to move these cells to a new place, give them a new environment, give them new feeding. So you can see that the ones that are not stem cells will start behaving differently. And if I say behaving differently, they won't remain in spots. They will start drifting away from becoming spots, and then we remove those clones.
So now we have these spots that might be stem cells, but we need to assess this new cell line and ensure it's of sufficient quality for our use cases. Firstly, we start by probing these now induced pluripotent stem cells with specific antibodies to identify key pluripotency markers. These markers, such as OCT4, NANOG, SSEA4, indicate the cell's ability to maintain a pluripotent state. As the antibodies bind to their targets, we can visualize and quantify the expression of these markers under a microscope. And strong and positive signals confirm the iPSC's pluripotent nature. We then perform comprehensive DNA sequencing. And this involves mapping the cell's genome to a reference, and it allows us to identify genetic abnormalities that might affect the stability of the cell line for future experiments. We also start trying to turn them into neurons at this stage, and that's just to test their capacity to differentiate and be useful for our purposes.
Yeah, so once these assays have determined or confirmed that we have a new cell line, and this cell line is indeed a stem cell line, we then expand these cells and then freeze these cells for 20 to 30 years. That's the good thing about cryopreserving of stem cells. So we can use them anytime that we need them.
So there you have it, the basic process for generating induced pluripotent stem cells from a blood sample. We have generated a number of cell lines in that way in-house to date and are actively working on making more of them.
Yes. So the upside or the good thing about this is we can store these cells for a very, very long time and we can culture them almost into perpetuity.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll both be back soon with another video. So stay tuned for more.
Thank you very much for watching. We're really lucky that we got the video time with those guys. That lab is really busy and those guys are managing a lot of stuff. There is one more video coming, and if you want to be notified about that, you can subscribe to the channel. And if you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them below or come join us in our Discord. Thanks again, and we hope to see you soon.
Because they're mono...
That's okay.
Efficient than the lentivirus. We'll get it. We'll take another.
Okay, cool.